is interesting.
Oh, well, I've just been shown a thumb here, meaning that I could start speaking. Maybe I'll wait for the question first, but maybe before the question is just to state that today is the 26th of October, the year 2009. We're sitting in a place in Pretoria on this Monday, and the artist, the other side of what you see here on screen, is a friend of mine, Cheryl Esop. Ma'am.
Good morning, Colonel. Morning. Colonel Piri, you have built the concept of into an exile from an exile. Can you elaborate?
Yeah, there is a debate that is brewing in South Africa today in relation to former freedom fighters who are now members of the security forces. The debate has to do with a perception that there's a domination of one group against another in terms of those who were participating from exile and those who were inside the country. And so there was a coinage of the term exile, which is not in the English dictionary. So, but I borrowed that terminology to go further with my, if you like, short biography that I've been writing for the past couple of months. I'm rather running short of time, so I thought I should record this to help me put my ideas together. I've already written in my short biography about my life, basically growing up, joining the struggle, leaving the country, and now I'm basically at the point where I'm about to return to South Africa around 93 and 94, hence the concept from an exile to an exile. So, in short, I arrived back in South Africa on the 5th of April 1994, quite in time for the first democratic elections in the country. And I'm arriving in South Africa coming from a very difficult situation in Dar es Salaam, in the company of the likes of Mofokeng Romero, who was my commander of APLA. In the company of the acting chief representative of the PAC, in the person of Monezi Gcilitse, also in the company of the likes of the late Benson Mandindi. So I'm flown back to South Africa on short notice. My wife, whom I had married 2 years before, with the full knowledge of my party and all those individuals mentioned above, is told that she must return to her countryside from Dar es Salaam, must return to Iringa. By that time, she's highly pregnant. And so I'm flown back to South Africa, like, you know, a reject of the liberation movement. When I arrived in, it was then the Jan Smuts Airport. They dropped me there, despite the fact that on the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees documentation, it was well stated that my home destination is a small dorpie called Amsterdam, next to Swaziland. My party just didn't care what happened to me after dropping me at the airport. And I then had to appeal to my uncle, that is the husband to my mother's youngest sister. They lived in Soweto, White City. I phoned them and he came with Fort Cortina to pick me up. And basically that was the beginning of what I call my inside, because the problems that I picked, let alone the problem that my wife was facing in Dar es Salaam or Tanzania, under a privation without a husband, a mere peasant in fact, without any assistance while she was expecting our baby, I started a new life now in Johannesburg, far more difficult than I ever experienced in my 11 or so years of exile. Maybe before I continue with the issue of my struggles in relation to my former organization and the South African National Defense Force, which I was, of course, preparing to join, I must talk a little bit about my family. I come from a member of a very large extended family, not only large, but also illustrious. From my mother's side, these are the Mavimbela people. They are renowned among the Swazi people. By the way, Swazis are to be found in Swaziland and in South Africa, and statistics show that there's more Swazis in South Africa than in Swaziland, and the culture of the Swaz is the same whether you're in South Africa or in Swaziland. So, but among the Swazi people, the Mavimbela clan is respected for prophets. The royal family of Swaziland has a religious background, if you like, and the leadership of the Swazi nation in all the challenging times, particularly during the Second World War, was led by a prophet who was a Mavimbela. It is that same clan from where my mother comes from, the Mavimbela clan. And now that was my grandfather, Mavimbela, maternal grandfather. And my maternal grandmother is a Dlamini. She's a direct descendant of the royal house of the Swazis. From my grandmother, who is Mafete, you go to Princess Skeyeza Dlamini, one of the co-founders of Mjindini Royal Crawl. And then whose father was Prince Kengana, the son to King Sobhuza I, the founder of the Swazi nation. So my family is quite illustrious maternally, and even paternally, it is the same background, if you like. Many people do not know this, but among the Zulu people of today, there are people who are of my own blood. Because before the rise of the Zulu nation, there was, prior to that, the Tonga people, who were comprised basically of the people of the Eastern Cape, like Aba Thembu, where Nelson Mandela comes from, people like Amampondo, and basically all the groupings with their own kings in the Eastern Cape were formerly Aba Tonga, Batuba Muroka. And then in what we call KwaZulu-Natal today, before the rise of Shaka, they were the people of Zwide, Ndwandwe, and there were the people of the Mteto people. They are all Amatonga, and that is that area where there is or there used to be the Matanje people. Matanje people then are the people of my father, because my ancestors were kings there. The Piri, Matanje Piri, was a ruler in ancient present day KwaZulu Natal. That is why now there's a confusion, because the Zulus as a clan, they came about 300 to 500 years ago. A few centuries before the white people came, the Zulus as a clan, the surname Zulu, and the Xhosas also as the Chawes, they also came together with the Zulus. They are closely related. But when they came, the Tonga or people of Moroka were already here for thousands of years in South Africa. It is from this arrival of the clans of Xhosa and Zulu that now European scholars deliberately say that every Bantu speaker is a newcomer. If Piri is part of the Bantu speaker, I'm not a newcomer. That is why you find the Piri clan among Basotho, Botswana, you find them in Zimbabwe, you find them in Malawi, you find them all over in Africa. You don't find them among the Zulus, because the Piris, the Matanje people, who are my clan in particular, they resisted Shaka Zulu's rise to power. So they were the people who then had to leave the country. The Tongas were to trek northwards because they went as far as Tanzania, known as the Ngoni people. So that's a bit of it. So it's quite an illustrious family I come from. So when I came from exile, maybe I had an exaggerated sense of myself. I was expecting my family, my grandmother's people, because my grandfather's people are now in Malawi, that they would welcome me and be very happy that I've come home. I was expecting that there would be maybe kind of a function to welcome him back. I've been a freedom fighter. I've made it possible for them to be like other South Africans. But I discovered that nobody was happy. Let's leave the extended family. We'll talk about the clan, the Piri clan, where I am born. I'm the first born surviving child of the Piri clan who live in Mayflower, Mpumalanga, next to Ermelo. You would expect now that as the eldest boy or child who has arrived home, everyone will be happy. But no, the guy who comes after me is Mr. Robert Piri. While I was gone away in exile, he was like the acting big brother of the household. There's a lot of cultural attachment to that. I get the feeling that my coming back didn't make him feel comfortable. He felt like this, the prodigal son. You know, I was coming back to usurp what he was like enjoying a status I do not know. But that is the kind of relationship I was having with my siblings. Then there was a girl called Grace Piri, who came after Robert, okay? And then the last girl is, the last two girls rather, Soneni and Kolisile. They were all inimical. That is how I ended up not even bothering to go to Mpumalanga, I settled in Joburg with my uncle, a man called Ephraim Beziwa Sithole. That is the gentleman who fetched me from the airport. The long and short of it is, my family, the extended family, is not quite big on ties, which is for me quite the opposite. I'm a person who is very fond of knowing where my relations, who they are, because I believe I can never know myself more fully than when I get to know my relatives, because every one of them has got a piece of me. If I know them, then I understand myself why I behave in certain ways. And that is basically that, but they don't believe in it. I can remember very recently, there's a third cousin of mine who lives in Nelspruit, on my maternal side, you know, a relative from my grandmother, the Dlaminis. When I was organizing a function about 12 months ago to meet them, to get that we know one another, that was done on my part now, at my own expense. I went around to Swaziland, Nelspruit, around Johannesburg, Pretoria, inviting them in person to participate in the function. And I must say thank you very much to one of my cousins. He's actually a second cousin, once removed, Father Mangaliso Mkhatshwa. He, the former mayor of Tshwane, he participated in that function. And many others. But I met that particular cousin, Nelspruit, and she told me openly, it sounds like madness. How can you go around looking for relatives, getting to know them? After knowing them, then what? So that gives you a picture on how different we are. We've got the same blood, but others don't think it's important to get to know one another. But I'm that kind of a person. I can tell you that from all the people I visited, even as far afield as Komatipoort, I drove about 4 tankfuls of my Toyota Corolla, trying to invite them. Only about 10% of them turned up. There was not even an apology to say we couldn't make it. But I did make the effort, and I think the arrival of Father Mansum Kajwa blessed the whole thing. He is currently, if I remember well, he is now heading some organization, more or less from the same office where he used to work before. The office of the mayor now is in the hands of Gwen Ramakgopa, by the way. But I hear that as of today, there's a lot of challenges in terms of service delivery. And it looks like the ruling party would consider an X. But anyway, that's the position that my second cousin, once removed, Mkhatshwa used to occupy. He is now heading a kind of an organization relating to other municipalities in Africa. He's more Pan-Africanist now. Excuse the pun, he's ANC, but more like Pan-Africanist Congress of Azania. And sometimes I sit and wonder why the PAC still exists. If the ANC is doing all the work that the PAC was dreaming of, why keep a separate organization for a purpose that another and bigger organization is already fulfilling? More so when the roots of this particular specialized organization, Pan-Africanistic organization, its roots are from the same mother party, the ANC. What is the raison d'etre of the PAC? Why is it still having a reason to exist? But now I'm going astray now. I want to come back now on my life in Johannesburg, where I'm preparing now to integrate with the ANC, or rather with the South African National Defense, where everybody under Mandela's administration was going to. Security forces in terms of the SNDF. Yes, we had a short break. My artist, the other side of this screen, had to take a stretcher. I'm coming back now. I've abandoned the issues of the family, which I just, picked them up to show a similarity in the way I am being treated or have been treated by my relatives. The similarity therewith, with the way I've been treated by my own organization, meaning APLA and the SANDF as of now. Okay. So my account now comes back to when I'm in Soweto, trying to integrate. And for a reason best known to the powers that be, Muromero Mufokeng, the APLA commander I lived with in the same house at Mwananchi building in Dar es Salaam, and he was now heading the integration process for the PAC and APLA in the SANDF. He did not know me. So I was like a fraud. I am pretending to have been a freedom fighter. I am not a freedom fighter. This is the man who was, as I've related on above, in my letter, who was with me and with other leaders of the PAC and APLA, including the then leader of the PAC, Johnson Mlambo, who knows me. He doesn't know me. He was integrating there, and all the people who worked with him, they just walked past me. I was still a member of the PAC. I was participating. I was actually the secretary of the Johannesburg branch of the PAC. And the people were just streaming in, going in for integration, and I was being passed by. The reason I believe is because Mfokeng is married to a closer speaking wife, who is Pearl, whom I know. Not only was Mfokeng being cooked for by my wife, whom they exiled, the Mfokengs of this world, they exiled to Iringa, but his wife as well, Pearl, when she had the break from Tanga, coming where she was studying nursing, coming to Mwananchi, my wife was cooked because she was working also for the PAC. And but now I had written when I joined the PAC that the reason why I had to leave my stint with the ANC in Dhaka was because of closer tribalism. There were individuals who were practicing tribalism. So I think Mfokeng felt that I was insulting his in-laws. So he felt he had to, you know, ingratiate himself with the closer speakers by punishing me together with Monezi Cilice and Benson Mandindi, who were instrumental in the whole thing. So for 4 years, I was basically close to a hobo, because I remember at some stage I was working somewhere as somebody who's looking after cars of a company, and I was earning 800 rand per month in Johannesburg. And if you took that money and you calculated the taxi from Joburg to Soweto, it was less than taxi money. And at some stage then I had to, you know, not go home to Soweto with my uncle. I had to stick around town, and now I had to sit at the park station at night, pretend I'm a passenger because I'm saving money so that I can have money, you know, to spend. So that's basically that. And for 4 years, then there was the issue, now what am I going to do, because my own comrades are denying knowing me. Then I wrote to the government of Tanzania. That was for the first time where the Tanzanian government came to my rescue, because I was working for the radio, which is a public institution. I was working as a deputy director for publicity information, electronic media. So I wrote to the Tanzanian government to say, please give me a document to say I was working under Radio Tanzania. And they wrote back. I took that document to TRC, which was led by Bishop Tutu. Now, very interesting, because Tutu is also Xhosa speaking. So Tutu asked me the first thing. First, when I submitted my application to be declared a victim of human rights, that was me, my wife, and my then unborn daughter, I expected an acknowledgement from Tutu, say he has received my application. There was no acknowledgement. I had to phone and demand an acknowledgement, which the wonderful bishop finally did and gave me that acknowledgement. And in those forms, we were asked, do you want the perpetrators or those who view as perpetrators to come? You have a talk with them to find a reason why they acted the way they do. I said, yes, of course. I'd like Benson to come and explain to me. I'd like Monez. By that time, I had not discovered that Mfokeng was part of the scheme. I was going all the time to the PAC office to Mfokeng, writing letters to him, and he was smiling at me and pretending everything is fine. I remember on one occasion, he even phoned Dar es Salaam, and he said to me, here is Benson, talk to him. And then I talked to Benson, don't worry, your wife is coming. And Mfokeng said, I will make sure myself that your wife comes. Only to find it never happened. So there with the TRC, Tutu and his grouping of the TRC never bothered to call Mandindi. Mandindi had to be sorted out by God through other means. He was coming from a funeral. He was now a high-ranking member of National Intelligence, a general there. He was coming from a wedding in Soweto, and he had in his car this SANDF corporal who had asked for a lift. It is said that as they arrived in Pretoria here, the corporal changed his story and said to Mandindi, look, we are a comrade. We're all together with APLA. The fact that you are a near general now should not make you special to me. Take me home. Don't drop me in town in Pretoria. I want to go to the township and